Welcome to BeFM Drama, where we turn great works of English literature into gripping radio. I'm your host, Joshua Cornwell, and today we're bringing you part three in our five-part adaptation of The Door in the Wall, a troubling and beautifully mysterious tale by the early master of science fiction and fantasy, H.G. Wells, whose prophetic late 19th and early 20th century visions of science and the future have had a powerful influence on the genres he worked in ever since. The Door in the Wall concerns the story of Lionel Wallace, an influential British politician of the late Victorian age. Wallace is dead now, having met his end suddenly under mysterious circumstances. His story is being recounted to us by his friend and former schoolmate, Mr. Redmond, to whom Lionel Wallace confessed everything over dinner a month before his death. The fantastic story Wallace told began when he was but 5 years old and stumbled on his wanderings across a strange door set into a tall, white wall. When the boy passed through that door, he found himself transported to an enchanted garden, a place of perfect happiness, a sanctuary of indescribable wonder and delight. Wallace has recounted to us the story of what he found beyond that door, and the suddenness with which he was cast out again and forced back into the drab world from which he came. Join us now for part three of our program as Lionel Wallace tells us what happened upon his return from that enchanted garden here on BeFM Drama.
Lionel Wallace sat across the table from me, lost in thought, thinking on his lost 5-year-old self, cast out of the garden. I spoke to break the long silence.
Well?
Poor little wretch I was, brought back to this gray world again. As I realized the fullness of what had happened to me, I gave way to quite uncontrollable grief. And the shame and humiliation of that public weeping and my disgraceful homecoming remained with me still. I see again the benevolent-looking old gentleman in gold spectacles who stopped and spoke to me, prodding me first with his umbrella. Poor little chap, he said to me. And are you lost, then? And me, a London boy of 5 and more. And he must needs bring a kindly young policeman and make a crowd of me, and so march me home, sobbing, conspicuous and frightened. I came from that enchanted garden to the steps of my father's home. That is as well as I can remember. My vision of that garden, the garden that haunts me still. Of course, I can convey nothing of that indescribable quality of translucent unreality, that difference from the common things of experience that hung about it all. But that is what happened. If it was a dream, I am sure it was a daytime and altogether extraordinary dream. Naturally, there followed a terrible questioning by my aunt, my father, the nurse, the governess, everyone. I tried to tell them, and my father gave me my first thrashing for telling lies. When afterward I tried to tell my aunt, she punished me again for my wicked persistence. Then, as I said, everyone was forbidden to listen to me, to hear a word about it. Even my fairy tale books were taken away from me for a time because I was too imaginative. Yes, they did that. My father belonged to the old school, and my story was driven back upon myself. I whispered it to my pillow that was often damp and salt to my whispering lips and childish tears. And I added always to my official and less fervent prayers this one heartfelt request. Please, God, I may dream of the garden. Oh, take me back to my garden. Take me back to my garden. I dreamt often of that garden. I may have added to it. I may have changed it. I do not know. All this, you understand, is an attempt to reconstruct from fragmentary memories a very early experience. Between that and the other consecutive memories of my boyhood, there is a gulf, a time when it seemed impossible I should ever speak of that wonder glimpse again.
I asked an obvious question.
No, I don't remember that I ever attempted to find my way back to the garden in those early years. That seems odd to me now, but I think that very probably a closer watch was kept on my movements after this misadventure to prevent my going astray. No, it wasn't until you knew me that I tried for the garden again, and I believe there was a period, incredible as it seems now, when I forgot the garden altogether. When I was about 8 or 9, it may have been. Do you remember me as a kid at St. Athelstan's?
Rather, of course I do.
I didn't show any signs, did I, in those days of having a secret dream?
He looked up with a sudden smile.
Did you ever play Northwest Passage with me? No, of course. You didn't cross paths with me often in those days. It was a sort of game that every imaginative child plays all day. The idea was the discovery of a Northwest Passage to school. The way to school was plain enough. The game consisted in finding some way that wasn't plain, starting off 10 minutes early in some almost hopeless direction and working one's way round through unfamiliar streets to my goal. And one day I got entangled among some rather low-class streets on the other side of Camden Hill, and I began to think that for once the game would go against me and that I would be late for school. I tried rather desperately a street that seemed a cul-de-sac and found a passage at the end. I hurried through that with renewed hope. I shall do it yet, I said, and passed a row of frowsy little shops that were inexplicably familiar to me. And behold, there was my long white wall and the little green door that led to the enchanted garden. The thing whacked upon me suddenly. Then, after all, that garden, that wonderful garden, it wasn't a dream.
He paused.
I suppose my second experience with that green door marks the world of difference there is between the busy life of a schoolboy and the infinite leisure of a child. Anyhow, this second time I didn't for a moment think of going in straight away. You see, for one thing, my mind was full of the idea of getting to school in time. Set on not breaking my record for punctuality, I must surely have felt some little desire to at least try the door. Yes, I must have felt that. But I seem to remember the attraction of the door mainly as another obstacle to my overmastering determination to get to school. I was immediately interested by this discovery I had made, of course. I went on with my mind full of it, but I went on. It didn't stop me. I ran past, tugging out my watch, found I had 10 minutes still to spare, and then I was going downhill into familiar surroundings. I got to school, breathless, it is true, and wet with perspiration, but in time. I can remember hanging up my coat and hat, went right by it and left it behind me. Odd, eh?
He looked at me thoughtfully.
Of course, I didn't know that it wouldn't be there. Schoolboys have limited imaginations. I suppose I thought it was an awfully jolly thing to have it there, to know my way back to it, but there was the school tugging at me. I expect I was a good deal distraught and inattentive that morning, recalling what I could of the beautiful strange people I should presently see again. Oddly enough, I had no doubt in my mind that they would be glad to see me. Yes, I must have thought of the garden that morning just as a jolly sort of place to which one might resort in the interludes of a strenuous scholastic career. I didn't go that day at all. The next day was a half holiday, and that may have weighed with me. Perhaps, too, my state of inattention brought down impositions upon me and docked the margin of time necessary for the detour. I don't know. What I do know is that in the meantime, the enchanted garden was so much upon my mind that I could not keep it to myself. And so we come to the end of this episode. as Wallace arrives at the portion of his tale that concerns his second encounter with the mysterious door in the wall. An encounter as a busy schoolboy quite different than the one he had as a small child of five. A boy barely out of infancy, innocent, lonely, and free of obligations. As we rejoin our story tomorrow, we learn of the consequences one can face as a boy in school when such a fanciful and seemingly absurd story is revealed to his peers. Peers with little patience for a lonely boy's impossible tale of an enchanted garden behind a magical moving wall. Join us tomorrow evening for the next part of Lionel Wallace's strange tale here on BeFM Drama. I'm Josh Cornwell, and I'm the host of this program. I played the role of Lionel Wallace. Our narrator, Mr. Redmond, was given life by the voice talents of Ryan Estrada.